So when we get to actually me starting, I can't say I'm going to start. They just fade it down, all right? Okay, so this one here is on number 4, and you can see it's on. Just bring me down a little bit now. And if during the event itself it's loud, I might say I'm booming a little bit. Just bring me down a bit. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. That's fine. Okay. And you have to make sure the volume's right on the stream as well. You know how to do that?
Yeah, the stream, I have it all the way up. That's what they told me to do.
Okay, good. And this is the other one. 1, 2, 3, 4. That'll be fine. Just a tiny bit down, I think. Yeah, a little bit down. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. That's perfect. Yeah. So that's totally all right. And Okay, well, welcome everyone, and welcome to all those streaming online to this fourth in our Developing Conscious series. And this will be the last of the series. We'll have a break and then possibly start again after Thanksgiving. We're looking today at the traditional of mystical reality. And those of you here last week, I looked at really my understanding of what the nature of enlightenment actually was. So I'm going to recap that a little bit. And I used a diagram that I'm going to show you now. I used this diagram last week really just to get an idea of what I was suggesting that the nature of enlightenment was. And I was saying last week that when people have an experience of enlightenment, I was suggesting that what they're actually experiencing is the deeper consciousness that exists in reality today. That really we experience our physicality in consciousness here. We experience through our senses what's going on in the world and what's going on around us. We then experience in our minds the sort of unconscious aspects of how we breathe and how we, all the things that we're not actually conscious of doing, you know, the memories, dreams, and reflections exist there. And then I was suggesting that really, that all things, that whether it's lecterns or pillars or chapels or people, everything that exists in the world has a fundamental spiritual DNA that it is at the heart of that thing. And that fundamental spiritual DNA was something that existed before the Big Bang and came out in the Big Bang as the rocks and particles and all the various things that were there. And the development, the evolution of everything as we know it today was really a force of consciousness that came out from that initial energy creation that happened right at the beginning. Come sit down, yep, that's great, at the Big Bang. And that somewhere in those rocks and in those particles was a latent spiritual DNA or a latent consciousness that manifested in those rocks sort of crashing into each other, the universe being formed. And with the universe being formed, particularly Earth being formed, and then life appearing on the Earth. And I was suggesting that the appearance of life on the Earth was a function of that consciousness manifesting itself in the appearance of that life. And that life was in those particularly original life forms, and that as the consciousness of those life forms developed and matured, that consciousness then enabled the development of all human, animal, plant species that exist. And so somewhere, you know, we as human beings are the flower of that evolutionary process. And we're different from everything that's gone before it. We're different from everything that's gone before it in that we can self-reflect. You know, I know, you know, your dog might self-reflect a bit and your cat more and your hamster less and maybe our guinea pigs less than that. And, you know, plants don't self-reflect, but they definitely, you know, they grow to, you know, how does a seed know to grow? There is something that is impelling it to grow. And there's something that's impelling it to go towards the sun. And there's something that impels it. And I'm suggesting that impelling force is actually, you know, what we call consciousness. And that as humans, we're able to self-reflect. And we are able to experience our experience, which means to say, I can say, I am experiencing myself experiencing you, and I can reflect on that, and I can be aware of that, and I'm aware of the nature of life and consciousness that's that's within me. I'm just making sure I'm broadcasting so you can hear me at the back, because last week we went off for a little while, so I know you can hear me now. So I'm reflecting on the fact you can hear me, and I'm reflecting on things. But actually, we have a greater ability as human beings, and that greater ability is to actually be aware and become conscious of that greater consciousness that's in all reality. Now, animals could actually be aware of that. We don't know whether they're not. But I was suggesting last week that when someone has that experience of enlightenment, experience of a sense of a greater self, experience of a being part of something greater, then actually what they're doing is actually experiencing the deep consciousness that exists everywhere, that exists in everything, that is the spiritual DNA that upholds all of life. Any thoughts or questions about that? Is that anybody want to ask anything? Or sorry, you think I nailed it? Yourself? That's very good. Thank you. That's very good. So, I mean, really, it's interesting that people have an experience of that. And they don't only have, when I described my experience of it last week, I described it in terms of seeing something. But I think other people experience it in terms of hearing things. Sometimes you hear something, people hear something. It's called, in traditional terms, it's called the music of the spheres. When you hear something that actually convinces you that there is an interconnectedness of all things, that somehow everything is of a one, and that we are connected in that way. And some people might experience it through touch. I mean, sometimes in sex, there's that experience of unity or oneness, that just realization that there is a deep connectedness in all things. And people do experience that, and they've written about it, and there's a sense of it being deep in the culture, in all cultures. And today what we're going to look at is really how cultures have interpreted that experience. I mean, there's a very interesting quote from Aldous Huxley's book, The Perennial Philosophy. And Aldous Huxley says in this book, The Perennial Philosophy, he says that the perennial philosophy is the phrase coined by Leibniz. He says, the thing of the perennial philosophy, it is the metaphysic. The perennial philosophy is the metaphysic that recognizes a divine reality substantial to the worlds of things, lives, and minds. So the thing of Leibniz calls the perennial philosophy is the metaphysic that recognizes a divine reality substantial to the world of things, lives, and minds. So that's what I was just describing. So the perennial philosophy says that there is somewhere in here, there is a spiritual DNA, a divine reality that exists within this that gives it its pillarness, and that gives Eliza her Eliza-ness, and gives those headphones their headphone-ness, and gives the beingness of all things. So that is the metaphysic. He says that it is also the psychology. So it's a thing and a psychology. It's a psychology that finds in the soul something similar to or identical with the divine reality. So it's a thing and it's a psychology that finds in the soul something similar to or identical with the divine reality. And that idea of the soul, I mean, I was talking about this the other day, that in the old days we used to think the soul was inside ourselves, that the soul's in there somewhere, have to look for our souls. And in fact, I think in the old days they used to dissect people, try and find the soul. Come in, Karen, how nice to see you. We used to dissect people to come and find the soul within us. But now we tend to think, actually, and it fits with this, we tend to think that the soul, rather than the body containing the soul, we have this idea that the soul contains the body. And that the soul is something greater than the body. That somehow your manifestation is more than just your physicality. I don't know anything about auras and all that sort of business, but that sense that, we know there is more. We can sometimes smell people And that goes beyond, I'm not saying it's value at all at the moment, but that goes beyond the body, doesn't it? And we can definitely hear people. You can hear me, and that so there is a sense of, you know, where does it end and where does it begin? In fact, when I'm saying it doesn't end and it doesn't begin, it is all, you know, the interconnecting. But, you know, the idea that the body is within the soul. So the soul, so what we're talking about, the perennial philosophy, it is the thing, the metaphysic that recognizes a divine reality substantial to the worlds of things, lives, and mind. It is the psychology that finds in the soul something similar to or identical with the divine reality. So whatever our soul is, whether it's in us or whether it's, you know, our body is in our soul, it's suggesting this idea of that there is a connection between that soulness of who we are and that divine reality, that spiritual DNA that we are talking about. And it is also the ethic that places man's final end, and woman's, but he doesn't say that, in the knowledge of the immanent and transcendent ground of all being. So he says, really, that your purpose is the discovery of this fundamental ethic within ourselves. It is the ethic that places man's final end in the knowledge of the immanent and transcendent ground of all being. So Leibniz is really saying that our whole purpose is to discover this in life. Your whole purpose is to discover this nature that is connecting all of us as being part of yourself. And that somehow that nature is always calling you. I mean, the reason you're here today is somewhere that nature has called you to be here today. And it is saying to you, oi, Karen, do you realize it is all of life is saying that to you? All the love affairs you've ever had, all the desires you've ever had, you know, all the money you've ever wanted, or whatever it is you've ever wanted, what he's saying is that somewhere that is the universe, that is the spiritual DNA calling to you to recognize that you are connected. And your desires misinterpret that. They say, oh, I must want this. I must want a husband. I must want a wife. I must want more money. I must want a better job. Really, what's calling to you is not the better job, house, wife, mother, whatever. What's calling to you is that fundamental spiritual DNA within all life saying, recognize who you are. Recognize your interconnectedness. So, he goes on to say that rudiments of this perennial philosophy can be found among the traditionary lore of primitive peoples in every religion in the world. And its fully developed forms, it has a place in every one of the higher religions. So he's suggesting that this idea that there is a oneness in all things is to be found absolutely everywhere in all religions. He says a version of this highest common factor in all preceding and subsequent theologies was first committed to writing more than 25 centuries ago. He said this idea was first recognized 25 centuries ago. And since that time, this inexhaustible theme has been treated again and again from the standpoint of every religious tradition and in all principal languages of Asia and Europe. So, in this book by Aldous Huxley, he's quoting Leibniz as saying that this idea that there is a fundamental spiritual DNA, there is a connectedness in all things, exists in all cultures. In fact, exists in all religions. And I think it's absolutely amazing when you look at different spiritual tracks that you can see that the similarity between the basic understanding in all these different areas. I mean, when we look at religions and cultures, we think of them being incredibly different. You know, we think of Islam, we think of Taoism, we think of Buddhism, we think of Christianity, really as believing hugely different things. But what's being suggested here is that actually, fundamentally, they are talking about the same thing. I mean, for me, religion is actually the enculturation of an experience that an individual has had. You know, Muhammad was in his cave. I was being interviewed on the radio once, and It was all about some Islam thing that had happened in the news, and I was being interviewed, and I was being, you know, typically like all, you know, expressing my views on the situation. And they said to me, "Have you ever read the Quran?" I was so embarrassed. I said, "No, I haven't actually read the Quran." And I made a decision at that moment that I was jolly well going to read the Quran and make sure, you know, that I knew what it was. And I did read the Quran. And funny enough, the Quran is, it's 40% the Old Testament, basically. 40% the Old Testament. 20% Muhammad's experience in a cave. Very similar to Buddha type thing. 40% is 20% is Muhammad's experience in a cave. 10% is how they were at war, and 10% is how to deal with the people they were at war with. Then 10% is how to deal with people that don't believe in what we believe in. So, you know, it's actually, you know, when you break it down, it's very similar. When you look at the New Testament, you could break it down in a similar sort of way. I mean, I've been reading the Old Testament actually recently, and all the last few books in the Old Testament are all saying, you're going to die in a terrible way and God's going to kill you because you've been awful. I mean, that's what really it says in the last few chapters of the Old Testament. Everything's going to fall apart because you're dreadful. You're all a bunch of whatevers, and God hates you because you've been worshipping the Asherah poles or whatever it is. I mean, it's all about that. And you know, a lot of the Old Testament is completely inappropriate. Just as inappropriate as Islam, funnily enough. But I think that basically that religions are an enculturation of an experience that an individual has had. So you had Muhammad in his cave. He had his experience. He wrote it all down. He told everybody about it. He got everybody to think it was a good idea. They did it all their way, walking around, you know, all that sort of business, throwing stones at the devil, all that. That's them. And then you've got sort of Buddhism. You know, he had an experience. He sat under the tree. You know, he did his bit. And they all, you know, said, this is a really good idea. And they, you know, they put on yellow and they, you know, went vegetarian and whatever they did in those days. And we have Buddhism as a result of it. Yeah.
But isn't Buddhism more of a way to live by, principles to live by, than a religion?
Well, that's very funny. Isn't Buddhism principles to live by? My brother, who's never been spiritual in his life, peace be upon him if he's watching at the moment, he has recently got into Buddhism through, Thich Nhat Hanh, and he's forgotten Buddhism. So I always mercilessly tease him. I always say to him, it's so good that you got into a religion like this. He says, it's not a religion, it's a philosophy, he always says, you know. And he's furious that I think he's religious. And they do think that, yes.
Yeah.
They do think that. And there is the enculturation there. We're not a religion, we're a philosophy.
Well, but
you have to use this because all the people watching in London, like Jeannie, hello.
Hi, Jeannie. But so as far as a culture,
yeah,
they're heart people.
Yes.
That culture is about living from your heart.
Yes. Yeah, you're saying that the Buddhism is a heart thing. Well, yeah, they've enculturated it like that. That's how it's. And you look at Christianity. You know, you look at Christianity's enculturation, right?
Yeah, what would you call that?
Well, it starts. Hang on. Starts off, you know, big Shazam when Jesus is born. I mean, something obviously happened. You know, there was an enormous explosion of something happening at that particular moment. You know, all these, you know, the disciples, Paul, they all went out, and there was deafening experience that some people had. And they wrote it all down, and then Paul decided what it was all about. And they, you know, went off and converted as many people as possible. And then there must have been something going on, because, you know, why else would you go and feed yourself to the lions? I mean, you know, the people did extraordinary things during that time.
Yeah.
And then the Emperor Constantine decided that this was the religion that they were going to go with for the empire. This is the religion they were going to go for with the empire. And so what they...
I am so sorry. This phone does that. I don't know how to make it stop.
The voices. Yes. I just hear the voices all the time. No, give me the drugs.
Okay.
Okay, someone's going. Okay, good. Just turn it off. That's right. Press the off button. There we are. Okay,
so put in the... One day it just started talking, okay. and, and it's been doing it.
Okay, great. So anyway, then the Emperor Constantine said, we're going to have this as an official religion. And so they took all the bits in Christianity that, you know, and they made an official religion. They had bishops and all that sort of business. And Christianity then became the official religion of the empire. And therefore, to not believe in Christianity was to go against the empire. And so Christianity then enculturated as a power vehicle. And then it became so that you had to believe in Christianity because that was what the empire told you to do. And therefore, the whole of the church structures became power-driven, became about a patriarchy, about making sure that people obeyed what you said. And if they didn't obey what you said, you set them on fire, or you cut their legs off, or you drag them through the streets. Or
isn't that how marriage started, too?
Marriage.
Isn't it, really?
I don't know. I won't get sidetracked into that, but I don't know how marriage started. That's another seminar. Okay, that's another lecture. But anyway, that's what happened. And then Christianity then developed, and it became this incredible power structure. I mean, look at the size of these cathedrals. I mean, they are statements of power. But that is the enculturation of the experience. That's how it manifests. And, you know, the essence of it is still there. Because even though these cathedrals are there, even though everything is speaking power, still the essential experience is within it. You know, that's why I'm here. I'm not here today because of power or anything like that. I'm here because somewhere there was an experience in there that touched me essentially and deeply. And it still does touch people. And people have made really, you know, lots of weird stuff about it. You know, it's now become about, you know, moral lifestyles. It's become about electing people. It's become a whole other game, you know, here and in other countries. There's a whole different agenda going on that may be about power, but it's also about control and how you behave, how people should behave. So that's enculturated like that. So what I'm suggesting is that religions are an enculturation of an individual's experience. And all these individuals that we're talking about seem to have had a similar experience. And I want to say how similar the essence of their writings are. And you can see it in the essence of their writings. I mean, I've called this session, you know, the tradition of mystical reality. Somebody emailed me and said, mystical reality, is that not a tautology? You know, two different things that mean absolutely not. But I don't think it is. In that Evelyn Underhill described mysticism as the art of union with reality. Mysticism is the art of union with reality. The mystic is a person who has attained that union to a greater or lesser degree. The mystic is the person who has attained that union with reality to a greater or lesser degree, or who aims or believes in such an attainment. So what the mystic is doing is actually wanting to experience that union of their consciousness and all other consciousness being of the same reality. And when we look at the nature of reality, we can go off. The one I've used beforehand here about reality is that which continues to exist after I've stopped believing in it. There's something essential that is eternal in reality. It continues to exist. You don't have to believe in it. You know, I was saying, you don't have to believe in gravity if you fall off the roof, do you? You know, you just get hit straight. You know, your body collapses on the ground. You don't have to believe in it. And similarly, there is an essence that is always there. So mysticism is the art of union with reality. And what I'm suggesting is that all the basic religions and cultures are all expressing that same deep reality, that same essence. Bede Griffiths was a Christian priest who went off to India and decided that he would actually find a common ground with Hindus in India. And he started an ashram in a place called Shantivaram. And he meditated and he created his own, you know, experience with the Muslims. And he says that the goal of each religion is the same. He doesn't say that each religion is the same. He says the goal of each religion is the same. It is the absolute transcendent state, the one reality, the eternal truth, which cannot be expressed, cannot be conceived. It is the absolute transcendent state, the one reality, the eternal truth. And he says that truth cannot be expressed, cannot be conceived. This is the goal not only of all religions, but he says it is the goal of all human existence. Whether they like it or not, all men are continually attracted by this transcendent truth. So it is the goal of all human existence to understand this transcendent truth. The intellect, in and beyond every formulation by which it seeks to express its thought, you know, the rational mind, beyond any understanding that it seeks to express its thought, is in search of the absolute. That our minds are constantly searching for this. The intellect is made for this being, for this truth, for this reality, and it cannot rest satisfied in any partial truth, in any construction of the human mind. It is always being carried beyond itself to the ultimate truth. So our intellects are always wanting to connect with this ultimate reality, this transcendent nature. And, you know, I like to look at the description of these in these different religions. And if you look at, for example, at the Tao Te Ching. Now, the Tao Te Ching was a book written by Lao Tzu in the 11th century. He says, it wasn't the 11th century. It was earlier than that. It was the 5th, 6th century BC. Anyway, that's how much I know. But the Tao Te Ching was written in the 5th, 6th century BC by Lao Tzu. And there's a lovely story about Lao Tzu. Lao Tzu just really means old man. And the story is that Lao Tzu was an abbot in a monastery. And he decided, as abbots do, that it was time for him to, you know, stop and go off into the caves and meditate for the rest of his life. So he left the monastery, there's a big service, everyone said, thanks very much, Lao, it's been great having you here as the abbot. And he set off with his staff across China to go to the caves of the mountains where he could meditate for the rest of his life. And he came across a river, the big river in China, whatever that is. And he decided he was had to get across the river, and there was no bridge or anything. So he saw a ferryman that could take him across. He went to the ferryman. He said, look, will you take me across the river? And the ferryman said, how much are you going to pay me? And he said, I'm a poor monk. I'm Lao Tzu. I haven't got any money at all. And the ferryman said, well, you must have something. He said, I only have my wisdom. So the ferryman, being a true capitalist, said, write your wisdom down, and then I'll take you across the river. And the result of that is he wrote the Tao Te Ching. Sorry, he wrote it. And it's a fantastic book, the Tao Te Ching. It's short for a start. Each little stanza is sort of a short amount like this. And they're wonderful little gobbets of wisdom, which I think are great. But this is number 14. And remember, I'm going to read you number 14 now. Remember, we're talking about this essential nature, this oneness, this mystical reality, this sense of the divine being within everything. And I'm suggesting that it's within all religions. And this is what it says in the Tao Te Ching, number 14. He says, look and it can't be seen. Listen and it can't be heard. Reach and it can't be grasped. Above, it isn't bright. Below, it isn't dark. Seamless, unnameable, it returns to the realm of nothing. Form that includes all forms, image without an image, subtle beyond all conceptions. Approach it and there is no beginning. Follow it and there is no end. You cannot know it, but you can be it. Be at ease in your own life. Just realize where you come from. That is the essence of wisdom. So it's suggesting an essential nature, again, that is within, that cannot be seen, which is very similar to the other descriptions. It cannot be seen, There is no beginning, no end. You can't know it, but you can be it. It is in your life. Realize where you come from. That is the essence of wisdom. And in the Upanishads, now the Upanishads is one of the Hindu scriptures. There are two, not that I know huge amounts about it, but there are two big Hindu scriptures, the Upanishads and the Bhagavad Gita. And the Bhagavad Gita is the story of Arjuna and Krishna and the relationship between action and inaction and yoga and all that sort of business. And the Upanishad is about the nature of the heart, where dwells the Lord. And it says in the Upanishads, it says, in the heart of all things, of whatever there is in the universe, dwells the Lord. Now, this was written centuries ago. You know, in the heart of all things, wherever in the universe, dwells the Lord. That's what it's saying. It's saying a very similar thing. He alone is reality. Wherefore, renounce vain appearances. Rejoice in him. Covet no man's wealth. Well may he be contented to live 100 years who acts without attachment, who works his work with earnestness but with no desire, not yearning for its fruits, he and he alone. Words there are without sons, covered up with darkness. To these, after death, go the ignorant, the slayers of the self. See, that's enculturation of... I mean, this whole thing about the fact that we, you know, have... other life, reincarnation. I mean, that is an enculturation. There's a lovely quote from the Dalai Lama. He was asked, what would you do if someone conclusively proved to you that reincarnation did not exist? And the Dalai Lama said, I would change my views accordingly. And so you've got to be open to that. You know, you don't know what the score is. So they think this. Anyway, it goes on. The self is one, unmoving. It moves swifter than thought. The senses do not overtake it, very similar to the last one. For always it does not move, it moves not. From the ignorant it is far distant, yet it is near. It is within all. It is without all. He who sees all beings in the self, and the self in all beings, hates none, goes before. Remaining still, it outstrips all that run. Without the self, there is no life. And so, you know, there is this idea that essentially, there is something right at the heart of all experience, right at the heart of who we are. And, you know, each of these religions suggests exactly the same. And, you know, if you think, oh, well, you know, these are the Eastern religions. They believe in this whole mystical thing. But, you know, if you look at the essence of the Christian gospel, it has exactly the same in there. There is exactly the same essential belief. I mean, in 1 Corinthians, it says, no, we speak of God's secret wisdom, a wisdom that has been hidden, that God destined for our glory before time began. There is this concept of a secret wisdom there. And then, you know, when Jesus asked, where is the kingdom of heaven? I mean, you know, in the Bible, most of the time when Jesus is asked a direct question, he goes off about birds of the air and seeds and sowers. And, you know, he doesn't give a direct answer back most of the time. But when he's asked the question, where is the kingdom of heaven? He says, the kingdom of heaven does not come from your careful observation. Nor will people say, here it is or there it is, because the kingdom of God is within you. Now, to me, that is absolutely exactly what we're talking about. He's talking about the kingdom of God being within you, that there is that interconnectedness that exists, again, within that whole Christian ideal. And again, in John, he's supposed to say, before long, the world will not see me anymore, but you see me because I live and you also live. One day you will realize that I am in the Father and you are in me and I am in you. Now, to me, again, that absolutely describes that interconnectedness. You know, I'm in the Father. I exist within that reality. You are within me. You exist within my conceptualization of reality, within my understanding. And I exist within you. So we exist as a whole together. And that, to me, is amazing that it is so clear that this is the way it is. And, you know, People don't tell this particular story in this particular way because that's the way the enculturation has happened. The way that it works for Christianity is to say that we're all sinners, that there was original sin, that Adam sinned, and therefore we're all ghastly as well. And then God needed Jesus to come along, and God needed Jesus to die so that we could be saved from our sins and blah, blah, blah. That is the story that's developed. And unless you go with that, you're not really going with the enculturation. And it's interesting to know that originally, in the old days, it wasn't God that demanded that. Yeah, this is what in the 11th century and before, it wasn't God that demanded that Jesus die, it was the devil. In the old days, they believed that the devil said to God, look, unless you give me something really important, you know, they're all going to be condemned to hell. So God then made a bargain with, a bit like, you know, God made a, like Abraham, God made a bargain. This is human sacrifice type stuff, remember? God made a bargain, said, okay, you can have my son, kill my son, and, you know, that's the score. But then, of course, you know, Augustine came along, and the idea of original sin came along, and then it was God that, you know, demanded that, you know, Jesus be put to death, said that the law, as if God would think like a lawyer. I mean, really. You know, God is supposed to have been the lawyer who said, no, I tell you what, we'll do this, and if Jesus dies, then you can all be freed, you know, like that. But actually, the modern thinking nowadays is that it wasn't God who demanded that Jesus die, or the devil. It was us. And that actually, what humanity needed was to actually observe someone who was totally willing to suffer and not blame. You know, it was the Jews who demanded that Jesus be crucified. It was the people we demanded. We just wanted him dead. And we wanted him dead because we didn't want the Romans to come in and kill us. But actually, in the theology of it, you know, the reason for the dying is much more to show the willingness to suffer and the willingness to have love be shown as being within. Because we all do suffer. And, you know, it's the one place where you see someone willing to be suffer, someone who's not getting away from suffering, but saying, this is how you live life. You live life within a context of love. You don't blame others for what's going on with you. You just live within that, and something great will come about. So I've gone off on a different track now, but what I'm really saying is that, what was I saying? I was saying that Jesus, you know, the old traditional way of thinking about Christianity is that Jesus died for our sins. And yet that's not really what I think the essence of it is. The essence of it is this other story, which is to say that the kingdom of heaven is within you, that I am in you and you're in me, you know, that whole story of that divine nature at the center of things. And you can see it right way through the Bible. I mean, right at the beginning, it says that when God made Adam, there was this understanding there, because when God made Adam, he made him of his own nature. He made him of his own likeness. So there was an aspect of godness being in Adam. There was an understanding of that. And you can see it quite clearly. I think the clearest you see is when Moses goes to is at the burning bush. And Moses is at the burning bush, and, you know, he's come out, and, you know, God's there. And he's at the burning bush, and God says to Moses, go and tell the pharaohs to let my people go. You know, go and tell the pharaohs. And Moses quite, you know, sort of obviously said, you know, who are you? He says, what should I tell them? Who should I say is making me do this? Actually, the words in the Bible are, Moses says to God, suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you. And they ask me, what is his name? Then what do I tell them? So Moses says to God, who are you? You know, what should I say? What's your name? And in the old days, in the Jewish times, in the Hebrew times, your name was very important. It meant something. You know, Isaac means something. I think it's he who's caught by the heel or something like that. They all mean, the names mean something. So he's really saying to God, what's your name? And, you know, he could have said anything. He could have said, I am the God of vengeance, or I am the God of hellfire, or I am the God of strength, or I am the God of justice. Any of those things he could have said, but he didn't. He said, God said to Moses, I am who I am. This is what you say to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you. So he says, this is what you say to the Israelites. I am who I am. I am has sent me to you. What he's actually saying, he's saying that Moses must go to the Israelites and say, the essence of who I am, my identity, has sent me to you. The connection that I have with you is this great I am. And the whole nature of God being, or that divine nature of being, essentially the identity of who we are. You know, when you say, who are you? You know, I am a woman, I am married, I am Karen. You can go through, and when you get to the final one, it is, I am that essential nature. And that is what God is saying to Moses. Tell, I am who I am. This is what you are to say, I am has sent me to you. And that concept of identity goes right the way through the New Testament as well. You have all the I ams in the Bible. Can you think of the I ams? What I ams are there? You know, when Jesus says, I am the
bread of life.
Thank you, the bread of life. Yes, I am the bread of life. What else is he saying? I am the true vine. I am the light of the world. Before Abraham was, I am. I've got them all written down here. I am the door. I am the good shepherd. I am the resurrection and the life. There we are. Thank you, Patricia. I knew you in there. I am the way, the truth, and the
life.
That's it. I am the true vine. God made man in his own. You know, that is the I amness. And you know, when preachers and vicars and priests get up to preach, they say, I'm going to talk about I am the true vine. Now, vines are like this, and they have that. And they all talk about the vineness. They don't talk about the I amness, which is what's being said. I am all those things. I am essentially. That I amness is at the essence of all things. You know, in 1 Corinthians it says, do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit? Who is in you? The Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God, you are not your own. This is the idea that we are living out of something else, that we are living out of an expression of something. And our first role is to work that out. That is really the next step on the way to evolution, is to work out what your place is in life. And what you are is an expression of that higher consciousness. You're expressed as Eliza. It is Eliza, the higher conscious, wandering around as Eliza, expressing as Eliza. Now, once you realize that, you realize that it is not you. I shouldn't be expressing the Nicholasness of who I am. I want to be expressing the essential nature of who I am. You know, which is why Paul said, let me be less, and you know, not me, but Christ in me. That's what that all means. You know, let me live that essential life within me. Let that essence come through. And we forget that. But once you realize that, the way that you live your life becomes different. The way that you live your life is you're living your life actually in service to that greater aspect. Your whole life is lived in service to that greater I am. And, you know, we think we live our lives in service by doing things. You know, we think, well, I'll go and serve meals at the senior center, or I'll drive people to hospital, or go and help with lift up. And, you know, that's what we think of as service. But actually, the essence of service is service to that greater consciousness, that essential I am that is there. And the way that you live in service to that is that you don't insist on the way it should go. You do what you do, and then you step back and you allow that greater essence to come through. It is a life of service to that greater essence. Not of saying, you know, kill all these people, you know, make my granny better and her leg better. It is in service to that. That lovely phrase as well, you know, in John it says, then you will know the truth and the truth will set you free. That is the truth to know. That is the essential truth that's being talked about. And, you know, you can look at it in that lovely phrase, you know, be still and know that I am God. You know, that is an essential thing. Be still and know that I am. The I am at the center of me is God. Be still and know that I am God. There's an essence that's being pointed right the way through in all of those different traditions. So, you know, what do you make of this conceptualization of reality, this interconnectedness? You know, how does it resonate with your experience? I'm asking you just to think about that. How does it resonate with you? You know, if you had that as an essence in your life, if you had that as a deep understanding that there was a fundamental interconnectedness, you know, all these great spirits, they seem to be pointing in that direction. You know, how does it resonate with you? So I'm going to ask you just to get into little three there, little three over here, and just have a little conversation together without the microphone, and then I ask you to come back together. So if you could just turn your chairs around. How does this resonate? I mean, you'll be able to say this in a little group. And those of you watching at home, you can either talk among yourself or just consider that. You know, how does this affect, if you did have that essence in your life, how would it affect it? So I'm going to give you just some time to talk among yourselves. That's great. Introduce yourselves and then just have a go. Okay, do you want to just turn around and face this way again? Just want to ask if any of you had any thoughts you'd like to share with those watching online or anything just in terms of just what you were having a chat about at the moment. Anyone like to share a little bit? Eliza, thank you. What were you saying? Eliza, thank you.
You're welcome. Well, we were talking about how it helps. It takes a lot of the pressure off when there is a force guiding you, when there is something bigger that's interweaving and connecting us all. You can kind of take a sigh of relief and be like, right, I don't have to figure it all out. I can relax a little bit more into what's happening right now and not always have to think so big picture. So it's a little bit more trusting and softening in life.
That is amazing, isn't it? Yeah. Because we're so fixated with making sure that the right outcomes come our way. I mean, all my life is spent trying to work out all the right outcomes. Yet my children's education, you know, what's going to happen? Making sure, you know, 100 people turn up on Sunday, making sure that we make our money, making sure that there's, you know, everything. It's all about that. And my whole life is geared towards madly trying to manipulate the universe. I mean, it's insane when you think about it, that I spend my life trying to manipulate the universe to go my way. And I spent all my energy trying to make that happen, rushing around the place, you know, making phone calls, doing emails, writing stuff, all because I'm trying to steer this enormous universe the way that I want it to go. And I think that it's right that it should go my way. I mean, isn't that insane? That I know. Whereas there is a wisdom beyond wisdom. Do you know, there is a wisdom beyond wisdom in this pillar. There is a wisdom beyond wisdom in the essence of the earth, in the essence of all consciousness that knows the way that it should go. And if I could just but give up to it, then my life would be a lot easier. I wouldn't be investing in the outcome, in what I wanted to have happen. I would be going with that. And really, that is the whole spiritual story, is to let go of trying to make it go the way that I want to, but to allow myself to be taken. You know, it says in the Bible, Paul says that we should become living sacrifices. That's sacrificio, to make holy. Ficio, make, sacre, holy. We are to make holy. And the way that you do that is you give up to it all. You were going to say something.
Well, just that it's a relief to know that it's not all about
yes.
me. It's to think that this huge whatever it is we're talking about to serve, to give my life to, and to try and participate with and allow that to come through is, you know, is an amazing, you know, lifetime's fun and games.
It is. Yes, that's absolutely right. Thank you. Yes, Patricia.
One of the things we talked about is, you know, this is all lovely, and it's not dissing this in any way, except when that bill is coming for the church, and you're trying to get it paid. So this would be, let's say, if I was speaking for myself.
Yeah.
And then you're like running around trying to da-da-da-da, all the things you just described.
Trying to get the $40,000 for gift day this
yes,
year.
Yes, right.
That's right.
And so, and it's like life's pushing at us,
yeah.
you know, for these things. And it's, and you know, Liza was saying it's always coming back to the breath. Of course, we know that. But what I, you know, experience is that's when it's the hardest to stay on that track. And then she was bringing up practice. That's why practice is practice. And just that I feel like that is a human thing that most of us experience what I'm speaking of. You just spoke about it.
Yes.
And in that, how do we, whatever what we're talking about and what we do as humans.
Yes. I think that's so interesting. The whole sort of idea, so when do we act and when do we not act? I mean, when you try and work that out, I'm going to talk a bit about this on Sunday, actually. When you try and work that out, you get into Ecclesiastes territory, which is vanity, vanity, all is vanity. You get into it, which is everything is meaningless. That's where you get to. How can I possibly make any meaning of this when I've got to pay the bill? That is that whole experience. It's the vanity, that's what you arrive at. And it's really well addressed in the Bhagavad Gita. In Bhagavad Gita is the story of Arjuna. And Arjuna is the prince who is on his chariot. And he's standing at the battlefield. And his charioteer is Krishna. And Krishna's the god. You know, his charioteer is the god. And he makes Krishna drive him out into the middle of between the two armies. And he looks at the other army, most of whom he knows. They're people that he's dealt with in the past. You know, he's, you know, the Hillary Clintons of this world, or whoever it was. You know, he looks at all these people. He says, why should I fight these people? What is the point? They don't want to kill me. I don't want to kill them. What is the point in acting? You know, what is the point in doing anything? And Krishna says to him, it doesn't matter. Your duty in life is just to act. You just have to get on with it and not worry about what the outcome is going to be. All you have to do is act. And if you don't act, you abnegate all responsibility for living. You're in this life to act. And the yoga, the union of everything, will take care of it. That's what he says. It's your responsibility to act. It's not your responsibility to work out what the fruits of your actions are going to be. That is the whole of the essence of the Bhagavad Gita. It is a commitment to act. And we have to, you know, that is why we rush about trying to find the bill or the $40,000 for gift aid or whatever day or whatever it is. That is why we do that. Our corruption comes in trying to manipulate the fruits of our actions. You know, we should be rushing about. I should be, but I shouldn't be worrying about it. You know, I should be doing all the things that I'm going to do, but I shouldn't be worrying about it. And that is where you exist. That is the point of existence, is to throw yourself in. You know, to be or not to be, that is the question. What it is to nobler, to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune. Yeah.
By opposing in them. Oh.
Perchance to sleep, perchance to... It's really about... Do I do it or not? Do I do it or not? That's what that question is. And Krishna says, you just got to go and do it. But do not be concerned about the result. You know, if I fail here at the chapel, I shouldn't be too worried about it. You know, there'll be something else. There'll be something else to do, you know. And while there is breath in my lungs, and while I can still, you know, recite the Vinaiti or, you know, the Lord's Prayer, there'll be somewhere for me to go, you know. And so, but I'm always so worried about it all. And what this is saying is you have this universe that's there, and you work in conjunction. And, you know, that wonderful other thing that Neil deGrasse Tyson said, which is the universe is under no obligation to explain itself to you. You know, awful things happen to us in our lives. Awful things happen. You know, we get ill. You know, people around us die. You know, we lose our money. We lose things. And actually, what we're being asked to do is to actually respond to those circumstances that we have out of a heartfelt love. We take the pain, and there is always pain in that. And rather than blaming someone else for it, rather than despairing, rather than, you know, complaining, what we do is we take that and we give love back into the world. And that's our role. Our role is to take the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune and to respond with love. And that is the message of the cross, just to be Christian. That is what it's about, is to respond with love. And, you know, I love the idea that God comes to us in the circumstances of our lives. But God asks us to respond to her rather than the circumstances. So God comes, the circumstances in our life upset us. And what we're being asked to do is we're being asked to respond to the essence rather than the circumstances. When something awful happens to us, what we're being asked to do is to respond with love. To take the pain of the grief and to respond in life with love. And by doing that, we transform. We are connected to everything. And by transforming our pain, we transform the universe. Yes, Karen, I'm going to give you a microphone. I know you don't want it, but I know that David Spencer, who's there, is watching, and various people, and I know he'll want to hear what you have to say. Yeah.
Well, our group, way undershot, anything very significant. We talked about people cutting us off in traffic.
Yes.
People taking our parking spot, having dialogue with someone, and no, you're totally on opposite ends of whatever. And so we talked about, you know, acknowledging that connection with other, like if someone, you know, cuts us off in traffic.
Yeah.
Maybe they have a sick child they're getting home.
Yes.
You know, and to look at it in a different way. And another thing, Nicholas, is going through this process Well, that's what it is. It's a process.
It's a process.
Instead of looking at the end result or getting a result that we're looking from other.
Yeah.
If we can feel good about the, you know, how we handle the situation.
Yes.
Well, that's as good as it can be because we have no control over that other person. So, I think that's.
That's
right.
Where Meryl started. If you think you're in control, what did you say? It was really
Control is an illusion.
Yes.
Control is an illusion. Yeah, it's a complete. There's no such thing. And that, what a freeing thing that is.
I think so.
Just to be freed in this moment in that is an incredibly freeing thing to be able to let that go and just to ride with the circumstances that appear in life. And our role in life is to transform those circumstances. It's not to control them. I say that again, our role in life is to transform our experience of those circumstances, not to control the circumstances. And in our transforming our experience of those circumstances, that is our contribution that we make to the transformation of consciousness.
Say that again, please.
The way that we transform our experience, the transformation that we facilitate in our consciousness by when something happens to us, if we are able to transform our experience, that transformation is the contribution we have to the transformation of consciousness. Our contribution in life is the way that we transform the way that we experience life. And we are part of that whole, and we make that offering to life itself. And at the end of it, you know, the Gandhi's response to the circumstances in his life was the contribution that he made. You know, Jesus's response, Muhammad's, their response to their circumstances was the contribution that they made. And we all have that opportunity to make that contribution. And it's an amazing thing to be able to do that. You've got to go early, I know. So, good. So, what we're going to do is just going to finish with a final, just a little meditation, which I always like this little meditation. And I say this is going to be the last of the sessions that we do on this particular course. We're going to take a break. We might start up again after Thanksgiving, but you've got to go as well, have you? But we'll see how we get on. But anyway, thank you for coming. That's brilliant. Thank you very much indeed. If you want to make a contribution, it's there. And also, could you just put the handouts here at the back just so they can take one? Karen, do you mind just putting these handouts at the back? Karen, do you mind just putting these at the back for me? Just the handouts at the back. Good. So, yes, I'm going to end with just a little meditation. Just to end this session. So if you're at home, just maybe close your eyes. And similarly here, if you want to just close your eyes for a few moments. I just want you to imagine that you're on the top of a mountain and you're looking out over the great city, and it's dusk and you can see the lights gradually coming on in the great city. You look out from your mountaintop and you see all the lights gradually flickering, coming on. You're looking across the whole thing. You're alone. What are your feelings during this? After a while, you hear footsteps behind you. You know that they're the footsteps of a holy man who lives around these parts. He comes up to you and stands by your side. And he looks at you gently and says just one sentence. If you go down to the city tonight, you will find God. Having said this, he turns around and walks away. No explanations or time for questions. Now, as you sit there on the mountaintop, you have a conviction that this man knows what he's talking about. What's your response? Do you feel like acting on his statement and going down into the city? Or would you rather stay where you are? What I want you to do, whatever your inclination was, is I want you to go down into the city. I want you to get up from where you are and just start to walk down the path towards the city. And make a decision that you are going to go and search for God and find God. You walk down the path and come to the beginning of the city. Where do you decide to go? Just follow the diktats of your heart in choosing a place to go. Don't be guided by what you think you ought to do or where you ought to go. Just go to where your heart tells you to go. What happens when you arrive at that place? What do you find there? What do you do there? What happens to you? Do you find God? If so, in what way? Or are you disappointed? What do you do then? Do you choose to go somewhere else, or do you just stay where you are? Now, I want you just to change this, and whether or not you have found God, I want you to choose some symbol for God, anything that you want to symbolize God. It could be the face of a child or a star or a flower or a tranquil lake or a flame. Choose a symbol to represent God. Having chosen that symbol, just stand reverently in front of it. What do you feel as you gaze at the symbol? What's your experience? Now, say something to it. What do you say to the symbol? Now imagine it speaks back to you. What does it say back to you? Now I want you to become the symbol. And having become the symbol, look at yourself standing out there, reverently looking back at yourself. What do you feel now as you see yourself from the viewpoint and attitude of the symbol? Now return to yourself standing there in front of the symbol and just stay with it for a while. And when you're ready, just open your eyes and come back into the room. Just open your eyes. Good. Well, I'd just like to thank everyone just for being here. Those of you, I know you're in London, I know you're Glenwood Springs, place like that, joining us online for these 4 weeks. There won't be a course next week, and we might do a secondary aspect of it maybe after Thanksgiving, but we're going to complete it here now. Thank you very much for joining us, and we hope to see you soon here at chapel. Thank you very much indeed. Great.
So this is the last one.
That's right.